job, Cindy. Typical fall day today. The announcements this morning are, we're still signing up for study school for those volunteers who want to work a couple of weeks out of the month. And we are still taking donations for dev coats. Remember, the deadline is very soon. Today. Go home, clean your closets, and bring it back. Lori, you want to bring up today's, what we're going to do today after church?
Oh, I'm sorry. After church, we're going to try to get the fellowship hall all set up for the dinner on Wednesday, so anybody can stick around and help with the tables and the line and everything. And maybe get a hold of anybody, and anybody wants to help out, I know somebody who can just let me know on Wednesday.
Do you need salads, or?
We're about even now, salads and desserts.
Yeah, so if we didn't get you a text or an email, please see me or Lori about the funeral service, which will be one thing going for Carolyn Lynn. Okay, let's stand and say this is the day and start the service with a smile.
So it's kind of hard. Sometimes the Bible's kind of hard for us when we're little, since our vocabulary is not as big as grown-ups. But the word in this is the Bible. The Bible is our word. That's where we learn stuff about being good people and loving God and Jesus and loving us. So the word is the Bible, and it says here the lamp. Have you ever seen a lamp that has like liquid in it and it's got a fire? Yeah, that's what they're probably talking about here, because they didn't have electricity in these days. So the word is a lamp unto my feet. Well, what do you do with your feet?
Walk.
You walk. And when we're talking about being in God's team, then we're walking forward. Okay? So we're going to walk, and it says the lamp, which is the light, is going to be the light unto my feet. Onto my path. The path is like when you walk the same place a whole bunch of times across somebody's yard, there'll be a path there. Have you ever done that? I have. Lots of times. Okay, so I thought maybe we should. Oh, look. Oh, it has to look like a speaker. See that? Sometimes the light's not too bright. Right here? Right here. Down there. Sometimes the light's not too bright.
Turn the light off?
this has got to switch. But when we're going with the light of God, the light doesn't ever go out. Even on a day like today, when it's really cloudy and dark, we look in our Bible, we'll find something that makes us light up. Because we said,
what'd
you say?
The sun's still shining, even if clouds are in front of it.
Yeah, even if the clouds are in front. Doing our view, when those clouds separate, what's going to happen?
The sun.
The sun's going to come out. And when we don't know what else to do with our lives, we open our Bible and we read and study, and the light will shine on the words of God. Want to say? Oh, I forgot to show you this light. It's really cool.
I think that's the same color of blue light that my camper has.
Is it? Okay. Anybody want to say?
The scripture reading today comes from John chapter 14, and this is the final installment in our series, Getting Unstuck. And today the topic is getting unstuck from grief. This context for this passage is the Last Supper. Jesus is gathered with his disciples, and as John tells the story, he greeted them by washing their feet. They sit down for the Passover meal, and he shares a lot of last bit information with them. They don't know what's coming, but he does, and this is his last chance to reinforce all of the things he has taught them. And he shares this with them. Jesus answered, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word. My Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. The one who doesn't love me will not keep my words. The word that you hear is not mine, but it is from the Father who sent me. I have spoken these things to you while I remain with you, but the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and remind you of everything I have told you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Don't let your heart be troubled or fearful. You have heard me tell you, I am going away and I am coming to you. If you loved me, you would rejoice that I am going to the Father, because the Father is greater than I. I have told you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you may believe. I will not talk with you much longer, because the ruler of the world is coming. He has no power over me." The heat index was topping out at ridiculous numbers. We were tired, so very tired. Our bodies were sore and our muscles ached, but we went on, one foot in front of the other. It was August 1988 in the South Carolina wilderness, known as Fort Jackson. We were almost at the end of basic training, and this stretch of days out in the woods would put all of our training not only into the context, but to the test. We had 3 hours to complete a 12-mile march, in full gear, plus a loaded rucksack and carrying our rifle. The heat was so pronounced that we began the march at 3 in the morning, so that the bulk of the march would be complete before the sun came up. It was long and arduous, and finally, after the sun broke the horizon, we finished. We took the final step of the journey. I will never forget the relief that came when I laid aside my rucksack and all of my gear. Without that heaviness, it was so much easier, indescribably easier. Being stuck in grief can be like walking around with all of that weight. Through the worst of conditions, feeling like it will never end. So what keeps us stuck? Well, you know, grief is enough in itself, and we grieve so deeply because the person we are missing loves us in a way that no one else does. And we miss that, and we feel the absence of it. Grief is enough. But we can get stuck in our grief when we get lost in the feelings of despair. Life is different. We do not, as a human species, like change, and then change is thrust upon us in a way that we don't want, we didn't ask for, and we're probably not ready for. Life is going to be different. And the other thing that can keep us stuck in grief is that we can't see the finish line, and we're not even convinced that there is one. The experience that we had in basic training wasn't a one-off. It was to give us the confidence that we could do it when the situation required it of us, and it revealed to us the muscles that we had developed and affirmed in us our ability to form the muscles that we need. I remember at one point being so sleepy and so bone tired. I mean, basic training is not a place known for its restfulness. And we were near the end. And I'm an 8 hours a night sleep kind of gal. So we were just so worn out, so tired, so exhausted, emotionally, physically, spiritually, all of that. I think I might have dozed off while we were walking. In fact, I'm pretty sure of it. I know that I closed my eyes because I could hear people in front of me, I could hear people behind me. As long as I didn't run into anyone, and as long as no one ran into me, I could just keep the legs going. Didn't need to have my eyes open. It was dark anyway. I wasn't walking alone. I was with a group of people. Had I been in that march alone, probably wouldn't have made it. But with that group of people, it was different. The entire experience was different. And the same is true in other aspects of life and other seasons in our lives. The people around us can make the difference on whether or not we're able to make it or not. In the passage that we read today, we know what was coming. We know what follows the Last Supper. We know that after this Passover meal together, they would go out onto the Mount of Olives to pray. Jesus would ask them to stay awake and pray with him. They kept falling asleep. And then a few hours later, Judas and the Roman soldiers came and arrested Jesus. Ultimately, he was tried and crucified, and then 3 days later, raised. We know that. The disciples didn't. When we read this passage, we can see that very soon they're going to be stuck. They're going to be profoundly stuck. Not only will Jesus be gone, his leaving will be traumatic for them. Afterward, each of them, in their collective trauma, will also be struggling with the weight of their personal failures to Jesus. enough, but on top of that, they had all of this other stuff, too. And the weight of what they would soon be carrying with them would feel crippling. Jesus knew that, and he wanted to comfort them, so he did the best he could at that moment. He gave them peace, his peace. He gave them a gift, not in the way the world gives, but by giving them what they needed, even though they didn't realize yet that they would need this. His gift to them was threefold. The first was forgiveness. He kind of pre-forgives them here in this passage. He tells them, don't let your hearts be troubled, and don't be fearful. He knew how they would soon react, and though they didn't realize it at the moment, he was offering them his forgiveness. The rucksack that we carry around that is grief is enough in itself. But when we carry around a bunch of guilt or a bunch of shame or a bunch of regrets over things that we said or did or left unsaid or undone, that can add so much weight to our journey. And you know what's going to happen? We are flawed people and we have imperfect relationships. That means that when we love each other, we're going to make mistakes. And it's common to feel guilt, especially when it's magnified, as grief tends to do, the guilt that we have. Jesus gave them the gift of laying it down. Already lighter. He also consoled them when he said, look, be happy for me. I'm going to be with God. It's hard to hold on to joy and hope when we're carrying around the weight of our grief, but it helps when we know that the one that we love and miss is not only no longer suffering, but they are made whole. And they are experiencing the exquisite joy of heavenly embrace. That's an available hope that can lighten a load. To watch the people that we love suffer, knowing that they're not. That's a relief. That's hope that we can cling to. And then he reminded them that they had each other. Jesus told them that the Holy Spirit would come to them and be a presence to them and a reminder of all that he had taught them. We too have the Holy Spirit within us. Since that day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit has come and it dwells within all of us. Prior to that, in Old Testament stories and in the days before Pentecost, we would read where the Spirit of God came upon someone, and it was there for a time for them to accomplish that which God called them to do, and then it would depart. Sometimes we, in some translations, read it as a mantle. He carried the mantle of God, or she carried the mantle of God, or the Spirit was with her for this time, or the Spirit enlivened his words. But from the day of Pentecost forward, the Holy Spirit dwells with us and stays with us always. Surround yourself with people who love and support you and whom you love and support, and let them help you carry this weight. Take a turn and carry theirs too. Friends who share the love of Christ are the best friends we can have. And and that they will talk to you about your person and let you talk about your person. Those friends are gold. Keep them close. And then listen when they need to talk about their person. But having the people with us can make the journey doable on our own. Who knows if we'd make it? But when we're with a group of people that love and care for us, that we love and care for also, the journey is different. So what does unstuck look like when it comes to grief? A heart that is open to love, a heart that can forgive, a heart that can accept life and love in all of its foibles and goodness. Unstuck grief looks like being able to claim available hope. Sometimes there isn't hope that will make everything go away. And if so, that type of hope is usually fleeting. But there's usually some available hope for us in a moment. Claim the available hope. Unstuck from grief looks like laughing again. A little more joy. A little more peace in our hearts, minds, and spirits. We're never going to be free of grief. We'll always have it. It's a sign of living this life. But when we can get rid of the other stuff, when we can lay aside the guilt and the shame, the regrets, when we can cling to the people that surround us, and when we lean into the hope that the ones we love are dancing with the saints and sharing in an embrace of heaven, then grief, though it is enough, it won't keep us stuck. Jesus came to give us his peace. My peace I give to you, he said. He doesn't give as the world gives. He gives us what we need. And what he gives is sufficient. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let's sing together.
Thank you.
have many joys and concerns in our community and in our world. What blessings do we have to share this morning? That's a pretty good soundtrack for blessings, if you ask me. Becky. Let's pray. Gracious God, we enter your presence this morning with joy, for you are the one who loves each of us beyond any measure. Oh God, the daily reminder of your goodness is reflective all around us. The brilliant colors of fall have sprung out in bright relief against the gray skies, and they remind us, oh God, that even though it's a cloudy day, your sun is shining brightly, even if we can't see it. Oh God, we thank you for these moments where we pause and can stand in awe of your goodness. We stop and recognize that you alone are God and worthy of praise. Oh God, you know the many concerns that bow us down today. Our minds are overflowing with so much stuff. Oh God, this world is in turmoil and chaos, and so many people are living with disaster and violence and trauma and war and disaster. And for them, we pray. Oh God, for those who don't have the basic needs each day of food, shelter, clothing, clean water, and the love of family and friends, for them we pray. And for those who are among our community who need healing in their bodies, minds, and spirits, we pray. Oh God, hear us now as we open our hearts to you and invite you to hear their deepest groanings. Gracious God, meet us where we are. Help us to lay down our grudges and guilt and regret. Console us with the images of heaven that await. And God, surround us with this cloud of saints that walk with us, who have raised us and taught us the faith, and those who walk with us today and share it. And God, we ask that you would send us forth as people who bear good news, that even in the darkest and cloudiest of days, your voice, your vision, and your love would be known. We pray these things in the name of your Son and our Savior, Jesus. Amen.
Morning. As we give from our heart, we sow seeds into God's kingdom. Galatians 6, verse 9 encourages us, and let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. Our giving will bring a harvest of blessings beyond what we can imagine. So today, please give from your heart with the joy and gratitude. Remember that your giving is impacting God's kingdom and blessing others. May we be faithful stewards of all God has blessed us with and give generously from our heart. receive this offering today, with it we worship you and give ourselves to you. Please accept our gifts and use them for your kingdom and your glory. Amen.
Jesus invites us to share the bread and the cup together as a community. And as we do that today, as we metaphorically come forward to the table, I invite you to come as you are, and whatever heavy stuff you're carrying, put that mess down in front of the table. Give it to the one who can transform it into blessing. Let us come together today and share in the gifts of God for the people of God.
That condemns, but with a righteousness that redeems. You have given us law so that we may know your way, and you have given us grace so that when we stray, you are there to forgive us and to give us a new beginning. We are tempted by the standards of the world, dear God, to follow values that are based on injustice and greed. Yet we know that you still invite us to dine with you. As we eat this bread and drink from this cup, help our hearts overflow with joy at having received Christ into our lives. Through your Spirit, teach us generosity and your passion for justice. Help us learn at this table that true joy in life lies not in taking, but in giving. Hear us now as we remember the prayer your Son taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Spirit.
And the courage of the Holy Spirit.